Hello students and welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Pooja Malhotra, Assistant Professor in Department of Commerce, Dyal Singh College, Karnal. Today we are going to discuss the topic Training and Development in International Context under the paper International Human Resource Management. After completing this module, you will be able to understand the concept of international training and development. You will be able to understand the various techniques of training and development, and you will be able to know about the evaluation of techniques of training and development. Now let's start with the introduction of the topic. Globalization and the continuous changes in information technology. These have brought a drastic changes in the work systems and structures of the organizations, particularly which are working on global level. These changes have made the existing jobs and systems redundant, and they require new jobs, new skills, flexible jobs and teamwork. To get competitive advantage at global level, it becomes essential for MNCs to develop their human capital on a continuous basis. For this purpose, international training and development have become an essential part of international human resource management. Continuous and lifelong learning have become essential features of human resource management. There are certain MNCs like Motorola, they are heavily investing in training and development programs of their employees due to their direct impact on gaining competitive advantage in international markets. The training programs may be self-directed or professionally directed by expert trainers. The purpose is to get the desired changes in behavior, attitudes, and performance of employees to meet the international challenges. The field of training and development is also known as human resource development, which includes all determined activities focused at learning, which can bring desired change in individual, group, or organizational behavior. Now, what is the role of training and development in international marketplace? Training and development programs play a crucial role in the achievement of organizational goals effectively and efficiently. So, there are certain ways in which training helps organizations in gaining international competitive advantage. So, these are, first of all, quality and customer satisfaction. The major and important factor in customer satisfaction is the quality of product or service. Training helps employees to achieve consistent quality performance by reducing the disparities of performance from high quality standards like total quality, ISO 9000 or Six Sigma movements, and achieve customer satisfaction. Reducing costs. Satisfying customers' needs at lower cost helps the organization to achieve competitive advantage. Through effective training, a company can reduce irrelevant and undesirable results and thus reduce adverse cost. The inability to adapt to customers' demand rapidly also results in undesirable costs in the form of loss of business to competitors who adapt rapidly accordingly. The well-trained and competent employees provide good quality products in time to have a competitive advantage. The next one is global mindset. Training and development programs help the employees to build global mind setup so as to adapt to global environments. MNCs employ employees from various countries having different attitudes, behaviors, values, etc. So training helps the employees to understand the foreign environments and adapt to foreign cultures, traditions, values, priorities, etc. Organizational learning and knowledge is the next benefit. Management organizational learning and knowledge management plays a strategic role in organizations competing globally. Training programs helps to find out knowledge and competency needs of employees and systematically transfer the knowledge and skills all through the organization. This collective training, learning and knowledge result into organizational learning. So the next benefit is global talent acquisition. MNCs require effective managers and leaders who have the abilities to think and compete globally effectively. So training helps the global professionals and leaders to develop core competencies and skills which are significant for the organizational success at global level. Now we are going to discuss the areas of international training and development. In business organizations operating at global level, different categories of human resources work, including parent country nationals, other country nationals, and host country nationals. Expatriates working on long-run basis in host country, also the host country nationals need to update their technical, functional skills, managerial skills, in addition to cross-cultural skills. Human relation skills are required for all types of employees, irrespective of their group and environment. Similarly, strategic management skills differ from country to country as they depend upon the environment of the country concerned. Hence, the organizations need to provide training in different areas and work continuously for their overall development. So, there are different types of areas of international training and development, which include, first is the technical training. Mostly MNCs appoint expatriates based upon their technical skills required to perform their job effectively. As they performed their previous jobs successfully, they feel comfortable initially in their overseas assignments, but the frequent technical and technological changes require MNCs to provide training to expatriates who take up long-run assignments to keep them updated in technology. Host country nationals also need technical training as most of them are appointed in MNCs without required technical skills. Hence, MNCs provide technical training to the host country nationals and expatriates who are on long-run assignments in view of the latest technological developments. Second area is functional training. MNCs need to provide training in different functional areas of organization, for example, accounting, production, sales, purchases, finance, etc., to host country nationals as well as to the expatriates on a continuous basis due to changes in organizational systems, structure, and procedures. The third main area is strategic management skills training. For strategic positions, MNCs prefer expatriates having high strategic management skills. Though they need to be updated with recent and competitive skills to be ahead of the customer expectations and competitors' strategies. MNCs aiming at developing host country nationals for strategic management positions also train and develop these employees in view of the importance of these positions. The next area is human relations or soft skills training. Human relations or soft skills include mostly interpersonal skills like interpersonal communication skills, leadership skills, motivational skills, team building, and skills of working in teams and groups, social skills, etc. MNCs provide training to both expatriates as well as host country nationals in all kinds of soft skills to enhance the human relations skills of managers under multicultural environment. The next important issue in training and development is cross-cultural training. Cross-cultural training is the most significant and critical training among all other areas of international training. Cross-culture emerges from the interaction of all categories of employees from different countries and cultures. All categories of employees have to adapt to others' culture to interact and work with them efficiently. Hence, an MNC provides cross-cultural training to all categories of employees, which include PCNs or parent country nationals, host country nationals of subsidiary, third country nationals, other types of expatriates, and employees of all partners of joint ventures. The companies adopt a systematic process of cross-cultural training, which includes analysis of organizational requirements, analysis of individual employees' culture, analysis of employees' job, formulating cross-cultural training goals, design and impart cross-cultural training, and evaluation of cross-cultural training. Analysis of organizational requirements. Organizational requirements for cross-cultural training are analyzed in terms of employee behavior, values, norms, attitudes, beliefs, and aptitudes that form the organization's structure, culture, strategies, power, and politics. This analysis also tries to identify the required training instruments to provide required skills to understand the organizational culture or the need to change one's own culture in accordance with organizational culture and requirements. The analysis also do cost and benefit analysis of cost cross-cultural training, its prospective contribution to goal achievements. Second is the analysis of individual employees' culture. This analysis includes the analysis of individual employees, both expatriates and host country nationals, in terms of their cultural backgrounds, behavioral requirements during the course of their interaction with other employees with different cultural backgrounds, prior knowledge and work experience of employees in cross-cultural environment, as well as living in foreign countries. In addition, MNCs should also analyze the cultural background of employees' family members to design the content of the training program. Third is the analysis of employees' jobs. The analysis of employees' job or assignment, along with tasks, duties, and activities, specify the cross-cultural knowledge and interpersonal skills required to perform the job most effectively. Next is the formulating cross-cultural training goals. After analyzing and identifying the training needs, MNCs formulate the cross-cultural training goals clearly. Generally, specific goals of cross-cultural training include line up the cultures of different categories of employees with that of organizational cultural requirements, making a balance between cultural differences and conflicts of different cultures, providing cross-cultural knowledge and required skills to employees to communicate and interact with the people of different cultural background and bring out cognitive, affective, and behavioral changes. Next step in cross-cultural training is design and impart cross-cultural training. After identifying the cross-cultural training needs, requirements, and goals, next step is to design the training program. It will contain the procedure and sequences of the training program. The training program will be based on the approaches of MNCs, like ethnocentric, polycentric, regiocentric, and geocentric approach. MNCs following ethnocentric approach prefer their headquarters to design, deliver, and evaluate the training program for all the subsidiaries with an objective to integrate culture of all subsidiaries with that of the headquarters. Integrated training program is designed to integrate the expatriate with host country culture as well as the organizational culture and culture of other expatriates working in same subsidiary. The training duration will be determined on the basis of training content, sequencing, level of understanding of employees, and pedagogy to be adopted. A variety of pedagogy instruments should be used to impart cross-cultural training. Also, cross-cultural training program can be conducted in different phases like pre-departure, post-arrival, and integrative training. The last step in cross-cultural training is evaluation of cross-cultural training. Cross-cultural training should be evaluated against predetermined training goals. It should be evaluated at each stage, like pre-departure and post-arrival stages, and also against both short-term and long-term goals. The next area of international training and development is language training. In international business, language plays a significant role. Though English is the international language, but most of the stakeholders like customers, suppliers, and market intermediaries may not feel comfortable in communicating in English language. In some of the countries, business transactions take place in languages other than English, like Arabic, French, and German, etc. Most of the times, MNCs don't employ host country nationals at all levels. They employ parent country nationals or other country nationals also for managerial and technical jobs. Therefore, MNCs have to provide language training to expatriates who cannot speak local or foreign language. Sometimes there are different technical terms which have different meanings in countries, even though speaking same language. Even within a country, there may be use of different languages. Like in India, there are different languages spoken in different regions. Hence, MNCs operating in India will have to impart training of these regional languages according to their needs. Next issue is global mindset training. Globalization at present is a comprehensive concept which includes globalization of business, globalization of culture, of technology, etc., the environment of the country, that is its culture, political factors, social system, etc., affects international business where it operates. These factors vary from country to country and sometimes from region to region, even in the same country. Companies operating at global level work on the theme "Think Global and Act Local," which means companies to think globally but act as per the local requirements. They have to design the products by taking in view the cultural, political, social, and other conditions of the countries where the MNC operates. Global mindset or comprehensive thinking by the employees will be possible if they have the knowledge and experience of working in different countries. In such cases, MNCs can have a comprehensive strategy, or it can also work on ethnocentric approach, that is the parent country strategies can also work for other countries too. To acquire global mindset, the employees of MNCs should sustain a holistic global approach, awareness of global behaviors and cultures, manage globally competing priorities, flexible, adaptable, and shift from one ego state to other ego state, have knowledge and experience of living and working across cultures, see the foreign country and markets from the aspects of nationals, involve in a variety of social and cultural events while working in foreign countries, and interact with a broad variety of people, conduct conferences and annual events for cultural adaptability. Employees exchange programs among subsidiaries and headquarters on short-term basis. Next is the pre-departure training. Pre-departure training is provided to the selected new candidates for jobs or the existing employees who are assigned jobs in other countries. This type of training is provided in the country where the employee currently lives or the nearby countries other than the prospective place of work. Pre-departure training is provided in areas like culture, language, preliminary aspects of the job, and business environment in the destination countries. Pre-departure training is not only provided to the selected candidate but also provided to his or her spouse, children, or other accompanying family members. Training for expatriates. There are various reasons for expatriate failure in foreign assignment, like employees' inability to adapt to social and cultural environment in the foreign countries, immature personality factors like less emotional intelligence, lack of technical and managerial skills, or lack of motivation to work in foreign countries. Providing training to expatriates and their family members is an important measure to reduce expatriate failures in foreign assignments. Expatriate training includes language training, cross-cultural training, field experience, in-house training program, in foreign exchange, international trade and economics and other related areas to provide managerial skills and job skills. In addition to these, a number of outside agencies and consultants offer training programs throughout the world to the expatriates to prepare them for foreign jobs. So MNCs can also take help of these agencies and consultants to provide training to these expatriates. Next area is the on-the-job training. After adjusting to the physical and general conditions of the foreign countries, expatriates strive to acquire cultural, interpersonal and technical skills related to job place and the job. Most of the time, employees acquire these skills most efficiently through on-the-job assignments. Employees get an opportunity to interact with colleagues, superiors, subordinates, and other stakeholders on the job and learn critical skills, tactics, and sensitive issues relating to foreign culture, like their values, ethical issues, interpersonal norms, etc. On-the-job assignments provide an opportunity to observe and study the behavior of stakeholders with regard to interpersonal skills, adapting to culture, decision making, leadership and functional skills, and develop his or her own skills in these areas. Last area in international training and development is team training. Team represents a group of employees having complementary skills. Performance of teams is far better than individual performance. MNCs train employees in team building and teamwork skills. They form teams comprising of employees from different cultures and hence values, norms, and behaviors along with different technical and functional skills. Working in team requires the employees to understand and adapt to culture, values, norms, and other behavioral aspects of other members of the team. Also, team as a whole has to behave as per the behavioral requirements of the team project or assignment and the organization. In initial stages, team members may find difficulties in understanding their cultures and behavior and adapting to each other's culture. But after a stage, they learn from each other regarding technical and functional skills along with other interpersonal skills and leads to significant human resource development and ultimately to organizational development. Now we will summarize the findings. Training and development programs play a crucial role in the achievement of organizational goals effectively and efficiently. To compete at international level, MNCs need to train and develop their human capital on a continuous basis. Different categories of human resources working in a globalized company, like parent country nationals, other country nationals, and host country nationals, they are provided with continuous training and development to update and develop their technical skills, functional skills, managerial skills, human relation skills, in addition to cross-cultural skills. It is also very essential for an organization to determine the effectiveness of training and development program. So, various techniques are available for evaluation, like experimental and control groups, time series analysis, cost-benefit analysis, and questionnaire and structured interviews, etc. With this, thank you very much.